Bonjour, bienvenue, and welcome to Algoma University's John Rhodes virtual celebration premier event. Although we are unable to gather together in person this year, as we have in the past, we are excited to welcome you to this special premiere of Through the Years, a Celebration of Celebrations, an event that resurrects the tremendous achievements and community leadership of the honorees recognized over the past 19 years at Algoma's John Rhodes Scholarship Dinner. Each year, this dinner recognizes the achievements of community members who exemplify the integrity, leadership, vision, and commitment to community services that was the hallmark of John R. Rhodes. Although the current pandemic has altered the format of this year's event, the need to support these students remains constant. For many students, scholarships and the generosity of our donors makes the difference in terms of whether or not a student can and will continue on with their university studies, their dreams, and their aspirations. The John Rhodes Scholarship Dinner has helped raise valuable funds in support of the post-secondary aspiration of a tremendously talented group of students who choose to pursue their academic dreams here at Algoma University. And as a result, the alumni of these scholarships are doing incredible work in our communities. A big thank you to the John Rhodes Scholarship Committee members for their creativity, ingenuity, and outstanding efforts in organizing this one-of-a-kind event. I know you will enjoy the event and the opportunity to experience a historical view of some tremendous community leaders and their families who have had an extraordinary impact on our community throughout the years. A heartfelt thank you to the sponsors and all of the ticket purchasers who are an integral part of the event. Without you, the event could not happen. We appreciate the continued support and contribution of your gifts to Algoma University and the entire community. We are part of an incredible community. I look forward to a time when once again we can gather together in person, but in the interim, on behalf of the entire university community, I invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy the show.
The practice of law is not a science, it's an art. And there's different ways to deal with the problem.
We are really a business that exports our knowledge from Sault Ste. Marie. And why Sault Ste. Marie? It's a fantastic place to live.
We are here to provide excellent solutions, and we're here to do it cost effectively.
When you need us, we're there. And when you have a need for a shorter meeting or something more cost effective, we can do that as well.
We differ from others in that we have a depth of understanding of the law, we have a depth of experience, and we have a good knowledge of our clients. So when you put all those things together, you really are providing the best service.
Our overhead factor is less than half what it is in Toronto. And so we can provide that competence and that advice at a much more effective cost. Contact us and see how we can provide you an excellent solution.
Hi, my name is Sam Yusuji. I'm the principal owner of Salden Group of Companies. We are very proud to be the 2020 event sponsor of the John Rhodes Scholarship. We certainly hope that this entire production will be the most enjoyable thing, not just the memory, but the most enjoyable part of all of the efforts that Algoma University and the business community has been able to put together in the last few years, and continue on for years to come.
The John R. Rhodes Scholarship was established in 1979 through generous donations from family and friends of the late John R. Rhodes. This prestigious scholarship, valued at $3,000, is given to a first-year student entering studies at Algoma University. The recipient must have demonstrated high academic achievement as well as demonstrated community leadership by being involved in social, political, or other extracurricular activities. The recipient may continue to receive the scholarship for additional 3 years, provided they maintain an average of 80% in each year. The John R. Rhodes Scholarship Dinner, now in its 20th year, is generously supported by our sponsors, ticket purchasers, and donors, and enables Algoma University to provide this scholarship to a very deserving student. It is my pleasure to introduce you to the 2020 John R. Rhodes Scholarship recipient, Isabella DiBerdino.
It really means a lot to me to receive this award because it recognizes all of my positive achievements and contributions that I've had to my school and community during my secondary school years. And I'm extremely honored to receive this award.
To the Sioux in 1967 after I graduated from university because I got a job at teaching at Sioux Collegiate. And John Rhodes was a personality that was well known in the city, in sports circles and in politics and on the radio.
I've known John for a long time. Most people don't know that I was a short order cook at Mike's Lunch than the night shift. When I was younger, and Mike and John was a beat cop. And after 3 o'clock in the morning, there was nobody there. He'd come in, have coffee, and we talked a lot. And I always felt he cared about people. He cared about people. It was never about money, it was doing something for people. That's the way he was. But he had a wicked, wicked sense of humor.
His talents, his quick wit, and his one-liners impressed everybody. And he became a cabinet minister held in high regard under the premiership of Bill Davis. And everybody believed that John was going to really go to high places in the government.
John would tell you, and he used to say this is, Don Mitchell is, Judy Mitchell's husband. I was never Don Mitchell, I was the husband of my wife.
The success and the achievements and what John Rhodes brought to Sault Ste. Marie as a standard and what others have tried to follow on is enough to motivate anyone to be better than what you can be.
We had another cop called Abby Mancuso, who was, he had the only motorbike that the police department had. I think it was a three-wheeler. He used to park it in front of Mike's and come in too, but not at the same time. They always used to come in separately. And I was sitting there having coffee with Abby, and he was telling me that he's being criticized by the superiors and everything, everybody down there, because he's always leaving the key in the ignition. And he says, who's gonna steal a motorbike? So the window was behind him, and I'm sitting there having the coffee looking, and I see John Rhodes in the window with Bill McComb at the paddy wagon. He's doing this, he's outside. They picked up Abby's motorbike, put in the paddy wagon, away they went. That's the way he was. I'll tell you, you never know what John Rhodes was gonna do.
He was on the morality squad. And of course, I had a grandmother that bootlegged, and she survived and raised families. And I can always remember John Rhodes busting down her door and coming in, and you know, and he actually said to me, he says, what's your name? And I told him, he says, where are you from? I said, well, I just came back from Montreal. I'm in dentistry. And of course, I knew him also on traffic and things like that, but he was a going concern in our community, and he achieved quite a degree of level of success.
You know, he started in radio, went on as a police officer, and then he became a politician and our mayor.
John and I knew each other quite well. Actually, we cooperated on a number of issues, one of which was helping to find a stabilizing grant from the provincial government to help to stabilize the finances of Algoma University College. And we worked together on that, and I wanted to announce it, but he said as a cabinet minister he should be the one that announced it.
The major one was close Algoma University, Algoma College, and send it to Sudbury. Everybody was shocked. We figured that was the end of the school. Now at that point, John was the Minister of Transport, John Rhodes, the Minister of Transport in the government. And we tried our best to try to ward this thing off, and one person saved us, that was John Rhodes. He told the Premier that this was a bunch of garbage. He told the cabinet this was garbage. The people of Sault Ste. Marie deserve access to higher education. I think if it hadn't gone his way, he would have resigned as a minister. That's the way he was. In the end, every rejection of the Whiteside report was thrown out. And to this day, I think that if it hadn't been for him, there's a good chance that we wouldn't have that university in Sault Ste. Marie.
Then tragically, as minister of the government representing Ontario, he was on an overseas trip to the Middle East, and on the aircraft over Iran, he suffered a heart attack and died very suddenly, an untimely death.
John had an outgoing personality that was second to none. He would have been our premier in Ontario if he had not passed away.
A group of his admirers decided to set up a scholarship fund with Algoma University, and they did. But the problem with many scholarship funds, at the time they're set up, there's high motivation to celebrate the death of someone who was loved or admired. And then eventually they peter out, the money gets depleted, and there's nothing left. And the university, as I understand it, having been on the Board of Governors, realized that might happen to the John Rhodes Scholarship Fund. And they set up this annual dinner to honor someone, and the proceeds would go to the fund, and it's been very successful.
It was after I retired from provincial politics, I was asked to join the Algoma University College Board, and I was happy to do that. I found, after I agreed, that they wanted me to be the chair of the board, which I thought was a bit sudden, since I hadn't been a member before. But the reason was they were looking to apply to the provincial government for an independent charter. At that time, Algoma University College was affiliated with Laurentian University, and they wanted to become an independent institution to grant their own degrees. But one of the first things that was reported to the board after I became chair was that the John Rhodes Scholarship was running out of funds. The awards of the scholarships had eaten into the principal of the initial contributions and donations. And the fund was no longer viable if it continued. We did not want, at least I certainly didn't, and I think most of the board did not want to see the end of the John Rhodes Scholarship. So we brainstormed about how we could try to replenish the contributions that would make it ongoingly viable.
Hello, I'm Dr. Celia Ross. I've been at Algoma University since 1982 as a professor of modern languages. I was president for 12 years, acting president for 8 months, and I recently retired.
We met with Jerry Norrie, who was a former chair of the Board of Governors, and we decided we would have a fundraising dinner to help raise funds for the scholarship. And then the question was, what would be the reason for the fundraising dinner other than just trying to raise money? And we decided that it would be a good idea to honor
community achievers, people who are community builders in Sault Ste. Marie. And by honoring them, we're going to bring people together to have a joyous and happy dinner. And we're also going to raise money for scholarships for the university.
The obvious choice for the first dinner was the Honorable Judge Greco, who had served as a provincial court judge, the longest serving provincial court judge of 36 years when he retired.
I felt in the company of greatness when I was around him. He contributed so much to our community. He contributed so much to the university. It's very sad that he's not here with us any longer, but I just had this deepest respect for him, and he always treated me so well. I learned a lot from him, and I feel very special to have known him.
That first dinner was very special just because it showed the enthusiasm of our community for supporting Algoma University, for supporting our students, and for coming together to honor people who've made significant contributions in the community.
Jerry Norrie and I spoke prior to me being on the committee, probably back in the 1990s, about the importance of having a university in Sault Ste. Marie and how much having a strong university would diversify our economy and what it could bring to the community. And I agree. I think Jerry had a passion for education. He wanted to see the university grow. Obviously, he was very involved in the school. And I had that same feeling, and that's one of the reasons I joined the committee.
Jerry worked tirelessly for this community in multiple areas, often behind the scenes. Spent a lot of time in Toronto when he was with the Progressive Conservative Party, away from his family, and a lot of time locally away from his family, supporting items such as Algoma College at that time.
The dinner we had for Jerry Norrie, it had a lot of meaning to it. And of course, Jerry wasn't well when we had the dinner, but we had so many people, so many kind words, and so many sponsors that came forward. We never really had that before. And that was another point that I think we all realized that we really have a special formula.
He was instrumental in keeping the university afloat back in the days when there was difficulties and it was still a college. Because of that, I drew an affinity to the university and then had the opportunity to facilitate a significant donation from Great West Life.
You know, when you think about what Algoma University stands for around special mission, I think this really, this dinner speaks to what we value as a community, which is helping. It's about giving back. It's about working together. And it's about engaging in partnership and collaboration to make our community a better place.
My name is Orlando Rosa. I'm the managing partner of a Wishart law firm. I've been practicing law over 37 years. I am a lifelong resident of the city of Sault Ste. Marie. And I can say from the outset that we were always very proud of our affiliation with Algoma University. It dates back many, many years.
When Morley came to Sault Ste. Marie, that's when Orlando and I joined the committee. The whole committee sold a lot of tickets. The dinner was held in the Doc Brown Lounge. Morley gave a great talk, intellectual humor. He gave a long talk that was very, very funny. And I remember after Morley's talk, I think we all had an epiphany. We looked at each other and we realized that this event would, we've grown too big for the Doc Brown Lounge. We have to move it out somewhere else.
Paul Delsig, to this community, I'm not sure how many people realized how special this man was and how much he gave of himself. You know, Paul was a Second World War veteran who, you know, had to parachute out during a campaign and was one of, I think, two survivors. But Paul came back to this community, self-made man, built up a business with the Canadian Tire Corporation. But then he gave back, and he gave back to the university and to the city in his time, his effort, and significant dollars. This was a man that I think a number of us would like to say we would like to emulate. None of us have been able to quite do it, but Paul is a visionary who has given and did give his life to this community and to the people that are at the university.
Before I was in politics, I was on the CRTC, and I'd spend a week in each province. I'd practice law in the Sioux and spend a week in each province. I really got to know the country as an administrator of television and radio. And then top it all off with the portfolio I had 603 First Nations to deal with, plus Yukon, plus Northwest Territories, plus Nunavut. And I really got to know this country. There's no country as good as this in the world. You know, it's just amazing to be a Canadian.
And I'm very proud to call Roberta Bondar a friend at this time. I got working with her through the Algoma Fall Festival on a couple of projects that we did. And think about what great things she's done for Sault Ste. Marie, what she's done for young women, having them aspire to their dreams and aspire to have a career in science. She's amazing.
So we called her and said, you know, we're doing this virtual grad and we want it to be sort of special, and we're trying to figure out how to do that. Do we think it would be amazing if you would say a few words of inspiration during this time of the pandemic? Well, she didn't miss a beat, and within a couple of days we had just an incredible video sent from her office speaking to our students about resiliency, about hope, about the planet, about how successful they were going to be, having moved through this pandemic, all that they had learned about technology, innovation, hope, and that they were going to be in a position to really make a difference in the future. She reminded them of the importance of the environment and not to take for granted what we have in this world. And I thought, you know, again, this wonderful woman from Sault Ste. Marie who has maintained her connection to this little community, despite the fame and all of the experiences she has, she still has a very soft spot. We see her often in our community. She comes back for many events and I think is always going to be connected to us. Speaks highly of Sault Ste. Marie wherever she goes.
We always have to be aware of what's happening there. Everybody in this community, you can't always count on a John Rhodes being at the top to save you. The responsibility of everybody in Sault Ste. Marie to understand what's being done, what skills are necessary for young people, and to get behind the university.
I was appointed to the Toronto court, and Ron became mayor. And after that, he went into federal politics at the time that Jean Chrétien was prime minister, and Ron became a cabinet minister. He had different portfolios. And when he retired from politics, he was named by Jean Chrétien ambassador to Ireland. Lately, they had a ceremony where they named our city hall after Ron Irwin. And I thought, what a great honor and well deserved.
Spent the summers running around diving, salvaging, and then gradually got into repairing docks and things like that. And if you're going to play tugboat, you have to have a barge. So I went down to Kingston and dragged a scow home. And so I was moonlighting for 5 years before I retired from teaching in 72.
We've been involved in the, since 1996, on the deep sea port for the community. Jack and Lou Quinlan have been heavily involved in that, and I, along with them, have sat on the committee for almost 20 years now. And Jack's knowledge has been a real asset for both for the community and for the Sault Ste. Marie port.
But his real love was down in the engine room, tinkering with the steam engine, and not in driving the boat. And periodically he would run ashore, and so someone with another boat would have to go out and pull him off and get him going on his way. And then often on his way home in the evening, because he realized he was running out of propane, he would run out of propane, and the tug would almost come to a stop, and he'd have to go into somebody's dock and see if he couldn't borrow a propane tank off of one of their barbecues to get him home.
I was involved in major hockey in Sault Ste. Marie and minor, and then suddenly I'm thrust into the issue of saving the Greyhounds, and that's a story that's well documented, and it's told many times and written many times. You know, Teddy was our coach for the Greyhounds for many years, and it was one of our first years in operation, and we were losing games by one goal. And everybody was crying for or yelling for Ted's firing. And I remember Sherry Basson says, when I give him a team to coach, then we'll decide if we should fire him.
Ted was is a great philanthropist as well. He has set up the Ted Nolan Foundation to assist Indigenous youth and Indigenous women in getting training and education to assist them to achieve well for their communities and for themselves in their lives.
I've followed Ted and had a chance to talk to him and just to get to know him a little bit better. And I think he is one of the most genuine people I've ever met. And he really is in his mother's name. And I would say it's part of who he is today as well. Really wants to see the young Indigenous people become successful.
Great thing about Ted in terms of coaching is that he is well known for being able to get the best out of all of his players, particularly younger players. He's very supportive and is a good teacher.
We probably did things in the sporting field that's never been done, and it can't be done anymore because they passed legislation to prevent it. Example, we asked people to buy a 3-year season's ticket, paid up front.
A lot of long nights in those days, and try to figure out a plan that would work, because the team was probably worth $500,000 and we had to raise $1 million, double its price, in a small community like Sault Ste. Marie. And in 30 days we were again very fortunate in being able to do it.
The idea of the three-year season's tickets came up from our daughter when we were typically around the kitchen table talking about things. And then, you know, we saved the team, kept it here, went to three Memorial Cups, won one in 93, but went to Quebec City, went to Seattle, and then, you know, we've continued to survive in the Ontario Hockey League. And, you know, it was a very emotional time. You know, the police chief led the Zamboni around Queen Street, and those who were there to remember it, which was 93, it was quite an event.
In 1992, Algoma Steel was really on the brink of collapse. At that time, we had political leaders in Canada, Brian Mulroney and Ronald Reagan in the United States, and the Prime Minister of England. All were outspoken in saying that only the strong should survive. And here we were in Sault Ste. Marie with Algoma Steel going into bankruptcy. We were able to get 22,000 people to pay a dollar each and become members in that corporation. And it was really important because having 22,000 members gave you the right to be able to speak on behalf of the community. So with the president of Algoma Steel, who was Gary Lucenti at the time, and Jack Ostrowski, the head of the union, the major union at Algoma Steel, and Joe Fortesi, we were able to lobby our government over a 48-day period to change the rules to allow employee ownership at Algoma Steel and to save the steel plant.
We are very blessed because of the university and the college here, in particular the university. It gives our young people an opportunity to learn and without having to leave home and be distracted by many other things, especially if we're looking at a time like we are right now in COVID. It's in our backyard. It's important that the youth today understand what's ahead of them, what they can do. The marketplace is evolving. IT is becoming far more pronounced. Biotechnology, things of that nature that the university can give them that we couldn't before. I could go out and be a salesman. There still are those opportunities, but the field is not the way it is. We're seeing things like micro certificates being done now at the university, giving the people to be able to adjust their careers as they move forward, and it's an evolving world.
When they named the scholarship after John Rhodes, some people say, well, what do you have to do with education? But I knew here that they made the right decision. It should have been named the John Rhodes Scholarship, and it was.
All of the people in this group for many years continue to work on behalf of the community, continue to work on behalf and make things better, continue to donate financial resources and their time. That's what makes this group really special.
Well, there were two very public highlights. The first was when we signed Algoma University College and Shimok Education Trust a covenant agreement. And that covenant agreement binds us to working together as equal partners for significant First Nations, Anishinaabe, cross-cultural, and settler education on our site. And the second very public happening, which was very significant, we had a wonderful community feeling that really Northern Ontario, Algoma, and Sault Ste. Marie were ready for a full-fledged independent university.
It meant quite a lot to receive the John Rhodes Scholarship
It allowed me to focus fully on my undergraduate studies, so I wasn't worried about funding my education as much, and so I was able to really immerse myself at Algoma U and take as many opportunities as I could in terms of research opportunities, and I think that really helped benefit me. I was able to work with Dr. Brandon Champ with a lot of ecology work through research studies, and I met a lot of the professors, and it helped me focus more on my degree.
I was able to graduate without any debt, which is really refreshing when you leave school and you don't have to immediately think, oh man, I got to pay this back. Now I have something looming over my head. I never had that. A lot of my friends did, and I know some of them, it takes years and years to pay that off. I feel like I'm in a good place now between the job I'm holding right now, with my family, everything's just kind of come together. And I'm thankful for that education.
We hope that not only will they succeed academically, but that they will also be well-rounded people who will serve their community in the future well, whether it be by helping out sports teams or whether it be by becoming a city councilor or a good volunteer. We hope to produce that kind of citizen for Sault Ste. Marie and that kind of citizen of the world. And the John Rhodes Scholarship and its criteria clearly point to the importance for students not just succeeding academically, but succeeding as people.
My dad got a bug for the lumber business, and he started to carry a little bit of lumber on consignment. And through whatever business he was doing in those days, he had business to do with the Hollingsworth family, with Sue Mill as a customer. And the three men, Lynn, Simpson, and Ian Hollingsworth, who became lifelong friends with my family, my dad in particular, they saw something in this young man. They had come from a family where the business was established, and they saw something in this young man who had absolutely nothing, but was working very hard to establish himself for his family. So they actually became the first shareholders in what was known then as Myers Builder Supplies. I look at the Hollingsworth men as men who have invested in this community. Their father invested in this community. Their children invest in this community. Their grandchildren invest. And you mentor, you look at other young people and how can you help them? And needless to say, my dad did enjoy some success and was able to buy back the shares. But those three men were his first shareholders, Ian Simpson and Lynn Hollingsworth. And in fact, Lynn and my dad became lifelong, very fast friends. And right up until days before my dad died, he and Lynn were exchanging books. And they mean a lot to our family.
When they decided that Timely Manor was going to be their place, I was, number one, first honored, but secondly, over the 30 years of having that restaurant, I was always honored to have the Hollingsworth family Christmas dinner, where it meant that all of the brothers and wives and children came to that dinner. Very seldom did any of them miss.
Well, first off, Fremlin was absolutely instrumental in the formation of what was then the United Appeal. The Welfare Federation of Sault Ste. Marie, Cora, and Terran Torres, was the official first name. He and others in the community, other community leaders, basically formed United Way.
Remember, the families would get together down the Windsor Park Hotel in the Oak Room, and he believed that bringing the family together, his sons and daughter and their kids, my cousins, was very important. I remember that he instilled in us how important family is. And the warmth he showed us, I strongly believe we have carried it on with all of us. She taught us about the importance of charity. She, in her own kind way, taught us how to give back to the community. She helped to shape our values of giving, loving, caring.
I think the one that stands out the most for me is surprising Dr. David Wald with Wendy McIsaac. and Mary Jane Lamb and all the way from Cape Breton for them to play a few tunes and so that he and his wife could step dance, which is a favorite pastime of theirs. I have a tremendous amount of respect for Dr. Wald, and I worked with him for many years. And just to be able to honor him in that way and to surprise him and see he and his wife get up and do a little jig on the stage, it was really fun.
We had two friends having to go for chemotherapy at the cancer clinic, which at that time was in a Butler building behind the Plummer Hospital. And the Dr. Wald and his staff were working in these very small quarters doing amazing things and lacking in a lot of essentials that we found out later in terms of pain pumps and extra equipment that they required. Just to keep everyone comfortable. Patients didn't complain, the staff didn't complain, but it was an obvious need. Our goal was to raise $1 million in 5 years, and the goal was to go into the cancer care fund, but ultimately the radiation bunker for our new hospital, which was just a dream at that time. We raised $1 million in our 5 years, and the radiation bunker is there in Dr. Wald's name.
Dr. Wald was special because we checked into the tartan of his clan. We made sure it was the appropriate one. We got heather because, again, of his background. It was very special because it was all, because I've known Dr. Wald for many years through my experience at the restaurant. I knew what his likes and dislikes were for food. And it was very, it was fun, but it was really, and he appreciated it. He actually made comment like it wasn't just a regular tartan, it was his, and how wonderful that was that we took care to make sure that it all worked. And we did that, and she ordered it, and we made it happen.
Well, I, as you know, grew up with the McDougall family. We were both families from down the line. And I think my family was very much about community and giving back. And so we often interacted and came in contact with the McDougall family as well, because they were very similar in the way they viewed community. And when I think about the parents and all of the work that they did for their community, I think that really transpired and is reflected now in their children. And I'm watching this amazing company now grow, and all of these local people working here in Sault Ste. Marie. The families made a very clear commitment that it didn't matter how large their company grew, they would always keep their roots in Algoma.
When I arrived in Sault Ste. Marie, I went around and introduced myself to the dentists that were practicing, and I went from office to office, and Dr. Lukenda took me under his wing. He set me up in practice, and our association with the Lukenda family, which is now continued with Tim Lukenda. But at the time, it was an unbelievable relationship, because no matter what we did, he'd say to us as his friends or confreres and says, would you like to do that? And we knew darn well we'd like to do that if he's going to be in it. And we never made a mistake.
May was an amazing partner for Lou. She raised seven children, yeah. Tim being the youngest, six girls and a boy. And she was his supporter. She was the epitome of the homemaker, baking, cooking, doing all the wonderful things that you need to do when you have a family that size.
His Honor Ray Startini is an incredibly intelligent person, an incredibly well-spoken, written, because he's written several books.
Yeah, another story about my parents' lives in Italy came to mind, and That went on for a year. My feet wanted to story another one would come. Then coming across the ocean, what happened when they arrived in Sault Ste. Marie, you know, new language, new culture, and all those things. So I wrote them down and that became a book. But that book, of course, was a lot autobiographical. So I grew up in the old West End, which was called at the time Little Italy. It was a wonderful neighborhood. A lot of good stories that came out of the West End I heard at the time and since. So I decided to put them down in writing before, while the people that gave me the stories were still alive.
But more recently, with both Jim and Ray, I had the opportunity to be part of a group that met once a month for dinner. And I was the youngest one of the group. So it was really interesting for me to hear all of the stories of their lifetime and the things that they were involved in.
The cronies are a unique thing, as far as I'm aware, to Sault Ste. Marie. They're a group of local business people that have been getting together either for lunch or for dinner for decades. They all give back in different ways within the community.
My son always tells me that, Dad, he said, with friends like yours, you don't need enemies because we're at each other all the time. Sarcasm is one of the things we use a lot. And again, my father said to me one time, you only tease the ones you love. Well, I love the cronies very dearly and we tease each other a lot.
Their friendship with each other and the way that they can rely on each other, their time that they spend around the table talking with each other and inspiring each other and challenging each other. There's been so many great evenings, you know, Ray Stortini reading his stories and listening to the wisdom of Darren McDougall, and there's so much great stuff comes out of that evening. And also to see the students, actually, the students that are receiving this award and this scholarship, and to hear from them and to see how it's going to make a change in their academic life.
The size of the John Rhodes fundraising dinners expand exponentially over the last 5 to 7 years. I remember attending in the early years when it was in the Doc Brown Lounge and there was 30 of us for the dinner. It's now grown to 300 people plus, and they're large, elaborate events that celebrate the people that have made a big difference in the community.
I have a couple of funny little stories about Donna. When Donna wants something to happen, I happened to say to her one time that I really wanted a cooking show. I believed I needed to have a cooking show. It was on my bucket list. Donna Hilsinger made it happen. She put 2 and 2 together, 3 and 3 and 6 and 8 and 10, and boom, we had a cooking show.
Donna Hilsinger, I've known since she was a young girl. And I was close to her dad, and we were on many boards, and I was his lawyer from 1973 until I retired. But was really impressed with her work for the trail, the Hub Trail, okay, where she took over as chairwoman. And at that time, they had been trying to get the Hub Trail going for probably close to 10 years. And she came in and rallied the people, and they raised the $50,000. They were able to get the proper engineering report, and with that, they were able to gain the $5 million that was necessary. And now we have this beautiful Hub Trail, 26 miles around our city, which is a tribute to Donna and her committee.
She makes things happen for people that are in need. A lot of times people don't know her generosity. She's very anonymous about her kindness, which I really respect. And I call her a true friend because of things like that.
Watching Donna grow up into the leader that she's become has been really a great, great feeling for me.
The students are always an interesting part of the dinner. Watching them get up and speak, some of them more comfortable speaking in front of groups, some of them not so much. They're also appreciative of the financial assistance that this scholarship has given. I remember some years they've stood up and said without it, they're not sure they could have come here and attended school. those are the ambassadors for Algoma University and Sault Ste. Marie that in the future will give back. They will in some way at some point come back and make a contribution to this community and this institution.
And I think when we listen to the stories of the award winners, these are the stories that resonate, and I think they get people excited about how they too can give back to their community and what can they do, even if it's not that large, what small thing can they do moving forward that will actually have an impact.
Well, I'd probably tell them to, you know, follow your dream and wherever it takes you, just don't give up, you know, because you can do a lot of good things. And most people who do graduate from university have a lot of time and they have a lot of skills that can be best utilized in a community. And if you want to do it, you can do it. There's no hesitation. There's lots of things you can do. And, you know, we would tell them, God bless you. Let's go.
If you believe, as a lot of us believe, that there should not be one law or one system for the rich and one for the poor, there should be universal opportunity to people who want to do it and have the ability to do it. It should not be hampered by lack of finances.
So being in the club, it means that in some ways we've made it as a community. There's a lot of larger communities that don't have their own university yet. And we do. It's been through the efforts of a lot of people to get it, and those efforts have paid off. A lot of these people that we've honored in the past were involved in that.
When you look at the list of honorees over the years, you know, you're humbled quite a bit because there's some really spectacular people and families that have accomplished great things in Sault Ste. Marie.
I've had more enjoyment giving back than I have taking. And you know, it's almost a cliche, people said, it's better to give than to receive. If I can say anything to everybody, that's an absolute fact, okay?
You know, industries can come and go, and we see that. You know, we put in our lost Algoma, and it changed, the face of Algoma changed. We lose industries here and there, but an educational institution will always be there.
I'm very happy to see the number of students that have benefited from the John Rhodes Scholarship over the years. And many of them have gone on to postgraduate work at other well-known universities, not just in Canada, but abroad. And without the John Rhodes Scholarship, some of those students might not have been able to complete their studies. And that's why it's such an important event to have a dinner that can raise money for these scholarships to assist students who are in need.
I think some advice I would give is that, as George said, follow your dream. It may not be the dream that someone else has, or it might be a different dream as you go past your university experience. But whatever it is, you're going to be doing it for a long time, so be happy with what you're doing. The way you find out if you're happy with what you're doing is try different things. Get involved with your community. Volunteer for whatever.
We bring in a lot of intelligent people to the city, and they contribute a lot, not just by being good teachers, but a lot of them get involved in extracurricular work and provide good leadership. So, and also it puts us on a level with some of the other cities.
And I used to be a lecturer in Lake Superior University across in Sault, Michigan. And my class, I enjoyed it. My class was about 25. And I looked for the people who had fire in their belly. We're only talking about a class 25, three or four. People who are going to go out and do something significant. Not make $1 million, do something significant. And when I looked at that list, what's unique about it, everybody on that list, everybody, had that fire in their belly that you ever get or possess.
Very gratifying. Like I say, if you can do something for people that can possibly do nothing for you, it's a great satisfaction.
We've always helped out United Way. We've always done, we've helped on the fundraising committee for Sault Area Hospital. So we've all got a little niche that we've all sort of done, and we all support one another.
I think we have a little pride. We're looking at Sault Ste. Marie, and we like to think we're the best, and we like to project that.
We all love Sault Ste. Marie, and it's a strong affection that we have for Sault Ste. Marie, and Sault Ste. Marie's been good to all of us.
It's all about making our community a better place, not for ourselves that are here now, but for their children and our grandchildren.
Well, you know, my father never had much, but he was a hard worker in the shrine in Thunder Bay. And he always used to tell me, if everybody would do a little bit in life for somebody, things would be a lot better.
You learn so much from other people when you volunteer. You learn so much about the selflessness of community members who are dealing with issues you never even dreamed of or sometimes didn't even hear of. So to find out what your passion is or what sparks you and gives you drive to do better, it's just to try different things so that you know what it is that you're going to enjoy for the rest of your life. And don't be afraid of the change.
Never, ever, ever give up. Okay, in every problem, there's an opportunity.
Nothing comes easy in life. Work really hard, give back, volunteer your time.
When you look at all of your honorees, I think that's a common denominator. They have achieved world recognition, they have achieved educational recognition, financial recognition, industrial recognition, and then at the end of the day, they all love this community.
Do everything you can to continue to learn, because it's an evolving world and it's even doing more today. So if you're out there, enjoy your life, be kind, love, and have faith.
This is our time. These
These are our plans. We're gonna let them shine. This is our place in the human race. And we won't stop dreaming. No, we won't stop dreaming. This is our world. And this is our time. This is our place in the human race. And we won't stop dreaming. No, we won't stop dreaming. We won't stop dreaming.